This channel has been established for visually impaired people. For the visually impaired people, voice narration and a written expression are also provided for the hearing impaired. Don't forget to subscribe to our channel. Bolshevik victory, abdication of Nicholas II, collapse of the imperial government, collapse of the provisional government, creation of the Russian SFSR, beginning of the Russian Civil War, belligerents, imperial government, a provisional government, Bolsheviks, Petrograd, Soviets, leftist socialists, commanders and leaders, Nicholas II, Georgi Lvov, Alexander Kerensky, Vladimir Lenin, Leon Trotsky, Lev Kamenev, strength, Imperial Russian Army, Red Guards, 200,000 until 15 March 1917, VE, Russian Revolution, February Revolution, July Days, Kornilov Affair, October Revolution, Kerensky, Krasnov Uprising, Russian Civil War, part of a series on revolution methods. Nonviolent revolution, nonviolent resistance, tax resistance, boycotts, samizdat, guerrilla warfare, coup, civil war, civil disobedience, rebellion, social revolution, communist revolution, industrial revolution, revolutionary terror, causes, capitalism, class conflict, corruption, dictatorship, economic depression, famine, feudalism, natural disaster, persecution, history, revolutionary wave, industrial revolution, commercial revolution, English revolution, Indian revolution, American revolution, Texas revolution, French revolution, Haitian revolution, Atlantic revolutions, revolutions of 1848. Xinhai Revolution, Russian Revolution, Chinese Revolution, Spanish Revolution, Cuban Revolution, Rwandan Revolution, Cultural Revolution, Iranian Revolution, Revolutions of 1989, Color Revolutions, Arab Spring, Politics Portal, VE, The Russian Revolution was a pair of revolutions in Russia in 1917, which dismantled the Tsarist autocracy and led to the eventual rise of the Soviet Union. The Russian Empire collapsed with the abdication of Emperor Nicholas II, and the old regime was replaced by a provisional government during the First Revolution of February 1917, March in the Gregorian calendar. The older Julian calendar was in use in Russia at the time in the Second Revolution that October. The provisional government was removed and replaced with a communist state. The February Revolution, March 1917, was a revolution focused around Petrograd, now St. Petersburg, then capital of Russia in the chaos. Members of the Imperial Parliament or Duma assumed control of the country, forming the Russian Provisional Government. The army leadership felt they did not have the means to suppress the revolution, resulting in Nicholas's abdication. The Soviets' workers' councils, which were led by more radical socialist factions, initially permitted the provisional government to rule, but insisted on a prerogative to influence the government and control various militias. The February Revolution took place in the context of heavy military setbacks during the First World War, 1914-18, which left much of the Russian army in a state of mutiny. A period of dual power ensued, during which the provisional government held state power while the National Network of Soviets, led by socialists, had the allegiance of the lower classes and the political left. During this chaotic period, there were frequent mutinies, protests, and many strikes. When the provisional government chose to continue fighting the war with Germany, the Bolsheviks and other socialist factions campaigned for stopping the conflict. The Bolsheviks turned workers' militias under their control into the Red Guards, later the Red Army, over which they exerted substantial control. In the October Revolution, November in the Gregorian calendar, the Bolsheviks, led by Vladimir Lenin, and the Workers' Soviets overthrew the provisional government in Petrograd and established the Russian SFSR, eventually shifting the capital to Moscow. In 1918, the Bolsheviks appointed themselves as leaders of various government ministries and seized control of the countryside, establishing the Cheka to quash dissent to end Russia's participation in the First World War. The Bolshevik leaders signed the Treaty of Brest-Litovsk with Germany in March 1918. Soon after, civil war erupted among the Reds, Bolsheviks, the Whites, counter-revolutionaries, independence movements, and non-Bolshevik socialists. It continued for several years, during which the Bolsheviks defeated both the Whites and all rival socialists. In this way, the revolution paved the way for the creation of the Union of Soviet Socialist Republics, USSR, in 1922. While many notable historical events occurred in Moscow and Petrograd, there was also a visible movement in cities throughout the state, among national minorities throughout the empire and in the rural areas, where peasants took over and redistributed land contents. 1. Background. 11. Economic and social changes. 12 Political Issues 13 World War 1 2 February Revolution 3 Between February and throughout October, Dual Power Dvovlasta 4 October Revolution 5 Russian Civil War 6 Execution of the Imperial Family 7 The Revolution and the World 8 Historiography 9 Chronology 91 Chronology of events leading to the Revolution 92 Chronology of the Revolution 10 Cultural Portrayal 101 Film 11 See also 12 Footnotes 13 Notes 14 References 15 Further reading 151 Participants Accounts 152 Primary Documents 16 External links Background Main article, Russian History, 1892-1917 Soldiers blocking Narva Gate on Bloody Sunday The Russian Revolution of 1905 was said to be a major factor to the February Revolutions of 1917 The events of Bloody Sunday triggered a line of protests A council of workers called the St. Petersburg Soviet was created in all this chaos. And the beginning of a communist political protest had begun World War I prompted a Russian outcry directed at Tsar Nicholas II It was another major factor contributing to the retaliation of the Russian communists against their royal opponents after the entry of the Ottoman Empire on the side of the Central Powers in October 1914. Russia was deprived of a major trade route through Ottoman Empire, which followed with a minor economic crisis, in which Russia became incapable of providing munitions to their army in the years leading to 1917. However, the problems were merely administrative, and not industrialist. Germany was producing great amounts of munitions whilst constantly fighting on two major battlefronts The war also developed a weariness in the city, owing to a lack of food in response to the disruption of agriculture Food scarcity had become a considerable problem in Russia, but the cause of this did not lie in any failure of the harvests, which had not been significantly altered during wartime The indirect reason was that the government, in order to finance the war, had been printing millions of ruble notes, and by 1917 inflation had made prices increase up to four times what they had been in 1914 The peasantry were consequently faced with the higher cost of purchases, but made no corresponding gain in the sale of their own produce, since this was largely taken by the middlemen on whom they depended As a result, they tended to hoard their grain and to revert to subsistence farming Thus the cities were constantly short of food At the same time rising prices led to demands for higher wages in the factories, and in January and February 1916 revolutionary propaganda, aided by German funds, led to widespread strikes The outcome of all this, however, was a growing criticism of the government rather than any war weariness The original fever of patriotic excitement, which had caused the name of St. Petersburg to be changed to the less German-sounding Petrograd, may have subsided a little in the subsequent years, but it had not turned to defeatism And during the initial risings in Petrograd in February 1917, the crowds in the streets clearly objected to the banners. Proclaiming «down with the war» heavy losses during the war also strengthened thoughts that Tsar Nicholas II was unfit to rule The liberals were now better placed to voice their complaints, since they were participating more fully through a variety of voluntary organizations Local industrial committees proliferated in July 1915, a central war industries committee was established under the chairmanship of a prominent Oktoberist, Guchkov, and including 10 workers' representatives The Petrograd Mensheviks agreed to join despite the objections of their leaders abroad All this activity gave renewed encouragement to political ambitions, and, in September 1915, a combination of Oktoberists and cadets in the Duma demanded the forming of a responsible government The Tsar rejected these proposals He had now taken over the position of commander-in-chief of the armed forces and, during his absence from Petrograd while at his military headquarters at Mogilev, he left most of the day-to-day government in the hands of the Empress She was intensely unpopular, owing, in part, to her German origin and to the influence that Rasputin, an unsavory monk, exercised over her All these factors had given rise to a sharp loss of confidence in the regime By 1916 Early in that year, Guchkov had been taking soundings among senior army officers and members of the Central War Industries Committee about a possible coup to force the abdication of the Tsar In November, Pavel Milikov in the Duma openly accused the government of contemplating peace. Negotiations with Germany in December, a small group of nobles assassinated Rasputin, and in January 1917 the Tsar's uncle, Grand Duke Nicholas, was asked indirectly by Prince Lvov whether he would be prepared to take over the throne from his nephew, Tsar Nicholas II None of these incidents were in themselves the immediate cause of the February Revolution, but they do help to explain why the monarchy survived only a few days after it had broken out Russian soldiers marching in Petrograd in February 1917 Meanwhile, the Social Democrat leaders in exile, now mostly in Switzerland, had been the glum spectators of the collapse of International Socialist Solidarity. French and German Social Democrats had voted in favor of their respective governments. Georgi Plekhanov in Paris had adopted a violently anti-German stand, while Parvus supported the German war effort as the best means of ensuring a revolution in Russia. The Mensheviks largely maintained that Russia had the right to defend herself against Germany, although Martov, a prominent Menshevik, now on the left of his group, demanded an end to the war and a settlement on the basis of national self-determination, with no annexations or indemnities. It was these views of Martov that predominated in a manifesto drawn up by Leon Trotsky at the time a Menshevik at a conference in Zimmerwald, attended by 35 socialist leaders in September 1915. Inevitably, Vladimir Lenin, supported by Zinoviev and Radek, strongly contested them. Their attitudes became known as the Zimmerwald Left. Lenin rejected both the defense of Russia and the cry for peace since the autumn of 1914. He had insisted that, from the standpoint of the working class and of the laboring masses, from the lesser evil would be the defeat of the Tsarist monarchy. The war must be turned into a civil war of the proletarian soldiers against their own governments, and if a proletarian victory should emerge from this in Russia, then their duty would be to wage a revolutionary war for the liberation of the masses throughout Europe. Thus, Lenin remained the enfant terrible of the Russian Social Democratic Labour Party, although at this point in the war his following in Russia was as few as 10,000 and he must have seemed no more than the leader of an extremist wing of a bankrupt organization. Lenin then executed the protests of Petrograd, which set off the 1917 Russian Revolution. Economic and social changes. An elementary theory of property, believed by many peasants, was that land should belong to those who work on it at the same time. Peasant life and culture was changing constantly. Change was facilitated by the physical movement of growing numbers of peasant villagers who migrated to and from industrial and urban environments, but also by the introduction of city culture into the village through material goods, the press, and word-of-mouth. Workers also had good reasons for discontent: overcrowded housing with often deplorable sanitary conditions, long hours at work. On the eve of the war, a 10-hour workday 6 days a week was the average, and many were working 11 to 12 hours a day by 1916, constant risk of injury and death from poor safety and sanitary conditions, harsh discipline, not only rules and fines, but foreman's fists, and inadequate wages made worse after 1914 by steep wartime increases in the cost of living. At the same time, urban industrial life was full of benefits, though these could be just as dangerous, from the point of view of social and political stability, as the hardships. There were many encouragements to expect more from life. Acquiring new skills gave many workers a sense of self-respect and confidence, heightening expectations and desires. Living in cities, workers encountered material goods such as they had never seen in villages. Most important, living in cities, they were exposed to new ideas about the social and political order. The social causes of the Russian Revolution mainly came from centuries of oppression of the lower classes by the Tsarist regime, and Nicholas's failures in World War I. While rural agrarian peasants had been emancipated from serfdom in 1861, they still resented paying redemption payments to the state, and demanded communal tender of the land they worked. The problem was further compounded by the failure of Sergei Witte's land reforms of the early 20th century. Increasing peasant disturbances and sometimes actual revolts occurred, with the goal of securing ownership of the land they worked. Russia consisted mainly of poor farming peasants, with 15% of the population owning 25% of the land. The rapid industrialization of Russia also resulted in urban overcrowding and poor conditions for urban industrial workers. As mentioned above, between 1890 and 1910, the population of the capital, St. Petersburg, swelled from 1,033,600 to 1,905,600, with Moscow experiencing similar growth. This created a new proletariat, which, due to being crowded together in the cities, was much more likely to protest and go on strike than the peasantry had been in previous times. In one 1904 survey, it was found that an average of 16 people shared each apartment in St. Petersburg, with 6 people per room. There was also no running water, and piles of human waste were a threat to the health of the workers. The poor conditions only aggravated the situation, with the number of strikes and incidents of public disorder rapidly increasing in the years shortly before World War I. Because of late industrialization, Russia's workers were highly concentrated. By 1914, 40% of Russian workers were employed in factories of 1,000 workers, 32% in 1901, 42% 32% worked in 100-1000 worker enterprises, 18% in 1-100 worker businesses in the USA, 1914. The figures were 18, 47 and 35 respectively. Years average annual strikes 1862-9-6-1870-8420. 1-885-9433-1895-1905-176. World War I added to the chaos. Conscription swept up the unwilling across Russia. The vast demand for factory production of war supplies and workers caused many more labor riots and strikes. Conscription stripped skilled workers from the cities, who had to be replaced with unskilled peasants, and then, when famine began to hit due to the poor railway system, workers abandoned the cities in droves seeking food. Finally, the soldiers themselves, who suffered from a lack of equipment and protection from the elements, began to turn against the Tsar. This was mainly because, as the war progressed, many of the officers who were loyal to the Tsar were killed, and were replaced by discontented conscripts from the major cities, who had little loyalty to the Tsar. The Petrograd Soviet Assembly meeting in 1917. Political issues. Many sections of the country had reason to be dissatisfied with the existing autocracy. Nicholas II was a deeply conservative ruler and maintained a strict authoritarian system. Individuals and society in general were expected to show self-restraint, devotion to community, deference to the social hierarchy and a sense of duty to the country. Religious faith helped bind all of these tenets together as a source of comfort and reassurance in the face of difficult conditions and as a means of political authority exercised through the clergy perhaps more than any other modern monarch. Nicholas II attached his fate and the future of his dynasty to the notion of the ruler as a saintly and infallible father to his people. This idealized vision of the Romanov monarchy blinded him to the actual state of his country with a firm belief that his power to rule was granted by divine right. Nicholas assumed that the Russian people were devoted to him with unquestioning loyalty. This ironclad belief rendered Nicholas unwilling to allow the progressive reforms that might have alleviated the suffering of the Russian people. Even after the 1905 revolution spurred the Tsar to decree limited civil rights and democratic representation, he worked to limit even these liberties in order to preserve the ultimate authority of the crown despite constant oppression. The desire of the people for democratic participation in government decisions was strong since the Age of Enlightenment. Russian intellectuals had promoted Enlightenment ideals such as the dignity of the individual and the rectitude of democratic representation. These ideals were championed most vociferously by Russia's liberals, although populists, Marxists, and anarchists also claimed to support democratic reforms. A growing opposition movement had begun to challenge the Romanov monarchy openly. Well before the turmoil of World War I, dissatisfaction with Russian autocracy culminated in the huge national upheaval that followed the Bloody Sunday massacre of January 1905, in which hundreds of unarmed protesters were shot by the Tsar's troops. Workers responded to the massacre with a crippling general strike, forcing Nicholas to put forth the October Manifesto, which established a democratically elected parliament, the State Duma. The Tsar undermined this promise of reform, but a year later, with Article 87 of the 1906 Fundamental state laws, and subsequently dismissed the first two Duma when they proved incooperative. Unfulfilled hopes of democracy fueled revolutionary ideas and violent outbursts targeted at the monarchy. One of the Tsar's principal rationales for risking war in 1914 was his desire to restore the prestige that Russia had lost amid the debacles of the Russo-Japanese War. Nicholas also sought to foster a greater sense of national unity with a war against a common and ancient enemy. The Russian Empire was an agglomeration of diverse ethnicities that had shown significant signs of disunity in the years before the First World War. Nicholas believed in part that the shared peril and tribulation of a foreign war would mitigate the social unrest over the persistent issues of poverty, inequality, and inhuman working conditions instead of restoring Russia's political and military standing. World War I led to the horrifying slaughter of Russian troops and military defeats that undermined both the monarchy and society in general too. The point of collapse. World War I. The outbreak of war in August 1914 initially served to quiet the prevalent social and political protests, focusing hostilities against a common external enemy, but this patriotic unity did not last long as the war dragged on inconclusively. War weariness gradually took its toll. More important, though, was a deeper fragility. Although many ordinary Russians joined anti-German demonstrations in the first few weeks of the war, the most widespread reaction appears to have been skepticism and fatalism. capitalism, hostility toward the Kaiser and the desire to defend their land and their lives did not necessarily translate into enthusiasm for the Tsar or the government. Russia's first major battle of the war was a disaster. In the 1914 Battle of Tannenberg, over 30,000 Russian troops were killed or wounded and 90,000 captured, while Germany suffered just 12,000 casualties. However, Austro-Hungarian forces allied to Germany were driven back deep into the Galicia region by the end of the year. In the autumn of 1915, Nicholas had taken direct command of the army, personally overseeing Russia's main theater of war and leaving his ambitious but incapable wife Alexandra in charge of the government. Reports of corruption and incompetence in the imperial government began to emerge, and the growing influence of Grigory Rasputin in the imperial family was widely resented in the eyes of Lynch, a revisionist historian who focuses on the role of the people. Rasputin was a fatal disease to the Tsarist regime in 1915. Things took a critical turn for the worse when Germany shifted its focus of attack to the Eastern Front, the superior German army. Class also saw remarkable changes, especially within the lower echelons, which were quickly filled with soldiers rising up through the ranks. These men, usually of peasant or working class backgrounds, were to play a large role in the politicization of the troops in 1917. The huge losses on the battlefields were not limited to men. The army quickly ran short of rifles and ammunition, as well as uniforms and food, and, by mid-1915, men were being sent to the front bearing no arms. It was hoped that they could equip themselves with the arms that they recovered from fallen soldiers, of both sides, on the battlefields, with good reason. The soldiers did not feel that they were being treated as human beings, or even as valuable soldiers, but rather as raw materials to be squandered for the purposes of the rich and powerful. By the spring of 1915, the army was in steady retreat, which was not always orderly. Desertion, plunder and chaotic flight were not uncommon by 1916. However, the situation had improved in many respects. Russian troops stopped retreating, and there were even some modest successes in the offensives that were staged that year, albeit at great loss of life also. The problem of shortages was largely solved by a major effort to increase domestic production. Nevertheless, by the end of 1916, morale among soldiers was even worse than it had been during the Great Retreat of 1915. The fortunes of war may have improved, but the fact of the war, still draining away strength and lives from the country and its many individuals and families, remained an oppressive inevitability. The crisis in morale, as was argued by Alan Wildman, a leading historian of the Russian army in War and Revolution, was rooted fundamentally in the feeling of utter despair that the slaughter would ever end and that anything resembling victory could be achieved. The war devastated not only soldiers. By the end of 1915, there were manifold signs that the economy was breaking down under the heightened strain of wartime demand. The main problems were food shortages and rising prices. Inflation dragged incomes down at an alarmingly rapid rate, and shortages made it difficult to buy even what one could afford. These shortages were a problem especially in the capital, St. Petersburg, where distance from supplies and poor transportation networks made matters particularly bad. Shops closed early or entirely for lack of bread, sugar, meat and other provisions, and lines lengthened massively for what remained. It became increasingly difficult both to afford and actually buy food. Not surprisingly, strikes increased steadily from the middle of 1915, and so did crime, but, for the most part, people suffered and endured. Scouring the city for food, working-class women in St. Petersburg reportedly spent about 40 hours a week in food lines, begging, turning to prostitution or crime, tearing down wooden fences to keep stoves heated for warmth, grumbling about the rich, and wondering when and how this would all come to an end. Government officials responsible for public order worried about how long people's patience would last. A report by the St. Petersburg branch of the security police, the Okhrana, in October 1916, warned bluntly of the possibility in the near future of riots by the lower classes of the empire. Enraged by the burdens of daily existence, Nicholas was blamed for all of these crises, and what little support he had left began to crumble as discontent grew. The State Duma issued a warning to Nicholas in November 1916. It stated that, inevitably, a terrible disaster would grip the country unless a constitutional form of government was put in place in typical fashion. However, Nicholas ignored them, and Russia's Tsarist regime collapsed a few months later during the February Revolution of 1917. 1 year later, the Tsar and his entire family were executed. Ultimately, Nicholas's inept handling of his country and the war destroyed the Tsar and ended up costing him both his reign and his life. February Revolution. Main article: February Revolution. Revolutionaries protesting in February 1917. Meeting Germans in no man's land. Meeting before the Russian wire and entanglements at the beginning of February, Petrograd workers began several strikes and demonstrations on 7 March. Workers at Putilov, Petrograd's largest industrial plant, announced a strike the next day. A series of meetings and rallies were held for International Women's Day, which gradually turned into economic and political gatherings. Demonstrations were organized to demand bread, and these were supported by the industrial working force, who considered them a reason for continuing the strikes. The women workers marched to nearby factories, bringing out over 50,000 workers on strike by the 10th of March. Virtually every industrial enterprise in Petrograd had been shut down, together with many commercial and service enterprises. Students, white-collar workers and teachers joined the workers in the streets and at public meetings to quell the riots. The Tsar looked to the army. At least 180,000 troops were available in the capital, but most were either untrained or injured. Historian Ian Beckett suggests around 12,000 could be regarded as reliable, but even these proved reluctant to move in on the crowd, since it included so many women. It was for this reason that when, on the 11th of March, the Tsar ordered the army to suppress the rioting by force, troops began to mutiny. Although few actively joined the rioting, many officers were either shot or went into hiding. The ability of the garrison to hold back the protests was all but nullified. Symbols of the Tsarist regime were rapidly torn down around the city, and governmental authority in the capital collapsed, not helped by the fact that Nicholas had prorogued the Duma that morning, leaving it with no legal authority to act. The response of the Duma, urged on by the liberal bloc, was to establish a temporary committee to restore law and order. Meanwhile, the socialist parties established the Petrograd Soviet to represent workers and soldiers. The remaining loyal units switched allegiance. The next day the Tsar took a train back towards Petrograd, which was stopped on the 14th of March, OS the 1st of March, by a group of disloyal troops. When the Tsar finally reached his destination, the army chiefs and his remaining ministers, those who had not fled under pretense of a power cut, suggested in unison that he abdicate the throne. He did so on the 15th of March, OS the 2nd of March, on behalf of himself, and then, having taken advice, on behalf of his son, the Tsarevich Nicholas nominated his brother, the Grand Duke Michael Alexandrovich, to succeed him. But the Grand Duke realized that he would have little support as ruler, so he declined the crown on the 16th of March, stating that he would take it only if that was the consensus of Democratic Action. 6 days later, Nicholas, no longer Tsar and addressed with contempt by the sentries as Nicholas Romanov, was reunited with his family at the Alexander Palace at Tsarskoye Selo. He was placed under house arrest with his family by the provisional government. The immediate effect of the February Revolution was a widespread atmosphere of elation and excitement in Petrograd. On the 16th of March, a provisional government was announced. The center-left was well represented, and the government was initially chaired by a liberal aristocrat, Prince Georgi Yevgenievich Lvov, a member of the Constitutional Democratic Party KD. The socialists had formed their rival body, the Petrograd Soviet or Workers' Council. 4 days earlier, the Petrograd Soviet and the provisional government competed for power over Russia between February and throughout October, dual power. Dvovlasta, the effective power of the provisional government, was challenged by the authority of an institution that claimed to represent the will of workers and soldiers and could, in fact, mobilize and control these groups during the early months of the revolution. Saw their role as limited to pressuring hesitant bourgeoisie to rule and to introduce extensive democratic reforms in Russia. The replacement of the monarchy by a republic, guaranteed civil rights, a democratic police and army, abolition of religious and ethnic discrimination, preparation of elections to a constituent assembly, and so on. They met in the same building as the emerging provisional government, not to compete with the Duma Committee for State Power, but to best exert pressure on the new government to act, in other words, as a popular democratic lobby. The relationship between these two major powers was complex from the beginning and would shape the politics of 1917. The representatives of the provisional government agreed to take into account the opinions of the Soviet of workers' deputies, though they were also determined to prevent interference in the actions of the government, which would create an unacceptable situation of dual power. In fact, this was precisely what was being created, though this dual power Dvovlasta was the result less of the actions or attitudes of the leaders of these two institutions than of actions outside their control, especially the ongoing social movement taking place on the streets of Russia's cities, in factories and shops, in barracks and in the trenches, and in the villages. The 2nd Moscow Women Death Battalion protecting the Winter Palace as the last guards of the stronghold. A series of political crises. There was enormous discontent with Russia's involvement in the war, and many were calling for an end to it. There were great shortages of food and supplies, which was difficult to remedy because of the wartime economic conditions. The political group that proved most troublesome for Kerensky, and would eventually overthrow him, was the Bolshevik Party, led by Vladimir Lenin. Lenin had been living in exile in neutral Switzerland and, due to democratization of politics after the February Revolution, which legalized formerly banned political parties, he perceived the opportunity for his Marxist revolution, although return to Russia had become a possibility. The war made it logistically difficult. Eventually, German officials arranged for Lenin to pass through their territory, hoping that his activities would weaken Russia or even the spring. Public dissatisfaction with the provisional government and the war, in particular among workers, soldiers and peasants, pushed these groups to radical parties despite growing support for the Bolsheviks. Buoyed by maxims that called most famously for all power to the Soviets, the party held very little real power in the moderate-dominated Petrograd Soviet. In fact, historians such as Sheila Fitzpatrick have asserted that Lenin's exhortations for the Soviet Council to take power were intended to arouse indignation both with the provisional government, whose policies were viewed as conservative, and the Soviet itself, which was viewed as subservient to the conservative government by some historians' accounts. Lenin and his followers were unprepared for how their groundswell of support, especially among influential worker and soldier groups, would translate into real power in the summer of 1917. Soviets attacking the Tsar's police in the early days of the March Revolution. On the 18th of June, the provisional government launched an attack against Germany that failed miserably soon after. The government ordered soldiers to go to the front, reneging on a promise. The soldiers refused to follow the new orders. The arrival of radical Kronstadt sailors. Aftermath: Lenin fled to Finland under threat of arrest, while Trotsky, among other prominent Bolsheviks, was arrested. The July days confirmed the popularity of the anti-war, radical Bolsheviks, but their unpreparedness at the moment of revolt was an embarrassing gaffe that lost them support among their main constituent groups, soldiers and workers. The Bolshevik failure in the July days proved temporary. The Bolsheviks had undergone a spectacular growth in membership, whereas, in February 1917, the Bolsheviks were limited to only 24,000 members. By September 1917, there were 200,000 members of the Bolshevik faction. Previously, the Bolsheviks had been in the minority in the two leading cities of Russia, St. Petersburg and Moscow, behind the Mensheviks and the Socialist Revolutionaries. By September, the Bolsheviks were in the majority in both cities. Furthermore, the Bolshevik-controlled Moscow Regional Bureau of the Party also controlled the party organizations of the 13 provinces around Moscow. These 13 provinces held 37% of Russia's population and 20% of the membership of the Bolshevik faction. In August, poor or misleading communication led General Lavr Kornilov, the recently appointed supreme commander of Russian military forces, to believe that the Petrograd government had already been captured by radicals, or was in serious danger thereof. In response, he ordered troops to Petrograd to pacify the city to secure his position. Kerensky had to ask for Bolshevik assistance. He also sought help from the Petrograd Soviet, which called upon armed Red Guards to defend the revolution. The Kornilov affair failed largely due to the efforts of the Bolsheviks, whose influence over railroad and telegraph workers proved vital in stopping the movement of troops. With his coup failing, Kornilov surrendered and was relieved of his position. The Bolsheviks' role in stopping the attempted coup further strengthened their position. In early September, the Petrograd Soviet freed all jailed Bolsheviks and Trotsky became chairman of the Petrograd Soviet. Growing numbers of socialists and lower-class Russians viewed the government less and less as a force in support of their needs and interests. The Bolsheviks benefited as the only major organized opposition party that had refused to compromise with the provisional government, and they benefited from growing frustration and even disgust with other parties, such as the Mensheviks and Socialist Revolutionaries, who stubbornly refused to break with the idea of national unity across all classes in Finland. Lenin had worked on his book State and Revolution and continued to lead his party, writing newspaper articles and policy decrees. By October, he returned to Petrograd St. Petersburg, aware that the increasingly radical city presented him no legal danger and a second opportunity for revolution. Recognizing the strength of the Bolsheviks, Lenin began pressing for the immediate overthrow of the Kerensky government by the Bolsheviks. Lenin was of the opinion that taking power should occur in both St. Petersburg and Moscow simultaneously, parenthetically stating that it made no difference which city rose up first, but expressing his opinion that Moscow may well rise up first. The Bolshevik Central Committee drafted a resolution, calling for the dissolution of the provisional government in favor of the Petrograd Soviet. The resolution was passed 10-2, Lev Kamenev and Grigory Zinoviev prominently dissenting, and the October Revolution began. October Revolution main article, October Revolution. Vladimir Lenin, leader of the Bolsheviks, speaking at a meeting in Sverdlov Square in Moscow, with Leon Trotsky and Lev Kamenev adjacent to the right of the podium. The October Revolution was led by Vladimir Lenin and was based upon Lenin's writing on the ideas of Karl Marx, a political ideology often known as Marxism-Leninism. It marked the beginning of the spread of communism in the 20th century. It was far less sporadic than the Revolution of February and came about as the result of deliberate planning and coordinated activity to that end. Though Lenin was the leader of the Bolshevik Party, it has been argued that since Lenin was not present during the actual takeover of the Winter Palace, it was really Trotsky's organization and direction that led the revolution, merely spurred by the motivation Lenin instigated within his party. Critics on the right have long argued that the financial and logistical assistance of German intelligence via their key agent, Alexander Parvus, was a key component as well, though historians are divided, since there is little evidence supporting that claim. On 7 November 1917, Bolshevik leader Vladimir Lenin led his leftist revolutionaries in a revolt against the ineffective provisional government. Russia was still using the Julian calendar at the time, so period references show a 25 October date. The October Revolution ended the phase of the revolution instigated in February, replacing Russia's short-lived provisional parliamentary government with government by Soviets, local councils elected by bodies of workers and peasants. Liberal and monarchist forces, loosely organized into the White Army, immediately went to war against the Bolsheviks' Red Army, in a series of battles that would become known as the Russian Civil War. Soviet membership was initially freely elected, but many members of the Socialist Revolutionary Party, anarchists, and other leftists created opposition to the Bolsheviks through the Soviets themselves when it became clear that the Bolsheviks had little support outside of the industrialized areas of St. Petersburg and Moscow. They simply barred non-Bolsheviks from membership in the Soviets. Not surprisingly, this caused mass domestic tension, with many individuals who called for another series of political reform, revolting, and calling for a third Russian Revolution, a movement that received a significant amount of support. The most notable instances of this anti-Bolshevik mentality were expressed in the Tambov Rebellion, 1919-1921, and the Kronstadt Rebellion in March 1921. These movements, which made a wide range of demands and lacked effective coordination, were eventually defeated along with the White Army during the Civil War. Russian Civil War. American, British, and Japanese troops parade through Vladivostok in armed support to the White Army. Main articles, Russian Civil War and Allied intervention in the Russian Civil War. The Russian Civil War, which broke out in 1918 shortly after the revolution, brought death and suffering to millions of people regardless of their political orientation. The war was fought mainly between the Red Army, Reds, consisting of the uprising majority led by the Bolshevik minority, and the Whites. Forces, they were ultimately defeated. The Bolsheviks firstly assumed power in Petrograd, expanding their rule outwards. They eventually reached the easterly Siberian Russian coast in Vladivostok, 4 years after the war began, an occupation that is believed to have ended all significant military campaigns in the nation. Less than 1 year later, the last area controlled by the White Army, the Ayano-Maisky district, directly to the north of the Krai containing Vladivostok, was given up when General Anatoly Pepelyaev capitulated in 1923. Several revolts were initiated against the Bolsheviks and their army near the end of the war, notably the Kronstadt Rebellion. This was a naval mutiny engineered by Soviet Baltic sailors, former Red Army soldiers, and the people of Kronstadt. This armed uprising was fought against the antagonizing Bolshevik economic policies that farmers were subjected to, including seizures of grain crops by the communists. This all amounted to large-scale discontent when delegates representing the Kronstadt sailors arrived at Petrograd for negotiations. They raised 15 demands primarily pertaining to the Russian right to freedom. The government firmly denounced the rebellions and labeled the requests as a reminder of the Social Revolutionaries, a political party that was popular among Soviets before Lenin, but refused to cooperate with the Bolshevik army. The government then responded with an armed suppression of these revolts and suffered 10,000 casualties before entering the city of Kronstadt. This ended the rebellions fairly quickly, causing many of the rebels to flee to political exile during the Civil War. Nestor Makhno led a Ukrainian anarchist movement, the Black Army, allied to the Bolsheviks thrice, one of the powers ending the alliance each time. However, a Bolshevik force under Mikhail Frunze destroyed the Makhnovist movement. When the Makhnovists refused to merge into the Red Army, in addition, the so-called Green Army peasants defending their property against the opposing forces played a secondary role in the war, mainly in the Ukraine execution of the Imperial Family Main Article, shooting of the Romanov family. The Bolsheviks executed the Tsar and his family on 16 July 1918 in early March. The provisional government placed Nicholas and his family under house arrest in the Alexander Palace at Tsarsko Selo, 24 km 15. During the early morning of 16 July, Nicholas, Alexandra, their children, their physician, and several servants were taken into the basement and shot, according to Edvard Radzinsky and Dmitry Volkoganov. The order came directly from Lenin and Sverdlov in Moscow. That the order came from the top has long been believed, although there is a lack of hard evidence. The execution may have been carried out on the initiative of local Bolshevik officials, or it may have been an option pre-approved in Moscow should white troops approach Yekaterinburg. Radzinsky noted that Lenin's bodyguard personally delivered the telegram ordering the execution and that he was ordered to destroy the evidence. The Revolution and the World Main Article, Revolutions of 1917-23. Leon Trotsky said that the goal of socialism in Russia would not be realized without the success of the World Revolution. Indeed, a revolutionary wave caused by the Russian Revolution lasted until 1923 despite initial hopes for success in the German Revolution of 1918-19. In the short-lived Hungarian Soviet Republic and others like it, no other Marxist movement at the time succeeded in keeping power in its hands. This issue is subject to conflicting views on the communist history by various Marxist groups and parties. Joseph Stalin later rejected this idea, stating that socialism was possible in one country. The confusion regarding Stalin's position on the issue stems from the fact that he, after Lenin's death in 1924, successfully used Lenin's argument.